everyone, today I want to review The Bell Jar by Sylvia Plath. I've finished this last week and oh my god, I loved it so much, and this is gonna be an appreciation video of The Bell Jar because there's literally nothing negative that I can say about this book. One of the best books I've read this year so far, and I would literally recommend it to almost anyone, except if you're triggered with things like suicide. This is a sort of warning. I won't discuss it in this video, but suicide, suicidal feelings and suicidal methods and stuff like that, that's discussed quite a lot in The Bell Jar. So if you're triggered by that, be careful with reading this book. Mostly in the second half of the book it plays a big part, but let me just start at the beginning. The Bell Jar is about Esther Greenwood's last month in college, sort of college, and her summer. Only about 30 pages or something, you find out that our protagonist is indeed called Esther. The first name she gives herself is a fake name, Allie Higginbottom, in a bar. Not important. The point is that this immediately tells you a lot about her personality, and that is that she struggles with identity, with who she is and where she wants to go. Society expects a lot of her as a woman. She's expected to marry and to get a lot of children. As a girl with a sort of scholarship in New York, it is expected of her to make good choices for her future and to become very successful, but she just struggles a lot with this. And there's this paragraph, and I just have to read it aloud because it's just so good. There are so many things that I underlined in The Bell Jar because it's just written so good. And her descriptions are just amazing. I can't find it. Where is it? Aha. There we have it. Like I said, her descriptions are amazing. Her writing style is just so good. I saw my life branching out before me like the green fig tree in the story. From every chip of every branch, like a fat purple fig, a wonderful future beckoned and winked. One fig was a husband and a happy home and children. Another fig was a famous poet, and another fig was a brilliant professor. Another fig was E.G., the amazing editor. Another fig was Europe and Africa and South America. And another fig was Constantine and Socrates and Attila and a peck of other lovers with queer names and offbeat professions. And another fig was an Olympic lady crew champion. And beyond and above these figs were many more figs I couldn't quite make out. I saw myself sitting in the crotch of this fig tree, starving to death just because I couldn't make up my mind which of the figs I would choose. I wanted each and every one of them, but choosing one meant losing all the rest, and as I sat there, unable to decide, the figs began to wrinkle and go black, and one by one they plopped to the ground at my feet. She just can't handle all the stress anymore, I think. I am always fascinated by books that, like, slowly, piece by piece, show more and more of what a character is really like, and The Bell Jar is definitely one of them, because slowly, by through flashbacks and everything, you learn more and more about Esther and about her problems, and she has very interesting opinions about marriage and about gender inequality and about the role of females in society. The book enabled you to form your own opinion about this. And it wasn't really important, but at the same time it played a really important part in the story, and it also was really important to Esther. And I just really like to see how her opinion changed and how you slowly saw how much it mattered to her. I thought it was very interesting to see how much all the expectations everyone had of her influenced her slowly becoming mad, because she gets crazy. She ends up in an asylum, she wants to commit suicide. Like I already mentioned, a lot of flashbacks are intertwined in the story, and although sometimes it isn't even clear whether you are reading a flashback or a part of the main story, in the end it's all clear, and it is like the story runs in a sort of circle. Just everything fits together so well, and it is so well done, and throughout the flashbacks you learn more and more and more about Esther and about her opinions and about why she acts the way she does in the end of the book. And The Bell Jar was quite an easy read. In my opinion, especially the first 50 pages remind me of a sort of chick lit. It takes place in New York, and Esther goes to parties, and these girls are described, and clothes and all kind of stuff are described, but in between the lines, it is very clear that Esther can't cope with this, and she can't act like the other girls do throughout the story. Just see everything developing, and her personality, and the madness, you see it developing. And that is actually the plot of this book. It's the getting to know more and more about Esther, and about her personality, and her opinions, and just the reasons for her madness. And that is interesting enough to keep you occupied. And I kept thinking and thinking about this book far after I finished it, because it really got me. And just the fact that Sylvia Plath committed suicide just 2 weeks after the publication of The Bell Jar, and that it's also semi-autobiographical, that just makes it so more intense, much more intense. I really can't wait to read more Sylvia Plath, because I just want to know more and find out more about this extraordinary writer and her life. And so good, please, let me tell you, read The Bell Jar. If you enjoyed It's Kind of a Funny Story by Nat Fizzini, the end reminded me of that one. I don't know what to say anymore. This video is quite long and it will probably be edited way too much, because my mind goes places when I talk about these kind of stuff that I have a lot to say about. If you've read The Bell Jar, please let me know what you thought of it. I'm really interested in hearing, as I have not heard a lot about this book. That's it for now, I think. Have a very good day, and I hope to see you next time. Bye!